very pleased again to welcome you all to the now sixth policy lecture in our Trade Dialogues series. Our speaker today is Professor Marc Muendler from the University of California, San Diego, who happens to be visiting us this whole week and working with us on issues related to, trade and labor for the World Trade Report. Mark is associate professor at the University of California, San Diego, and has worked as a consultant to the World Bank and private businesses, and as a consulting researcher for the Brazilian government, the German Central Bank, and the Federal Reserve of, Bank of New York. He received his PhD in economics from the University of California, Berkeley, and was a research fellow at Princeton University. His work has wide policy implications, amongst others with regard to adjustment policies, and in particular, skill development policies, issues that are dear to our heart right now. It has been published in leading journals, such as the American Economic Review or the Review of Economic Studies. Mark will discuss the impact of trade integration and multinational production on the changing task assignment to occupations and the skill requirements of jobs, highlighting consequences for wage inequality and employment. I wish to warmly thank Mark for having accepted our invitation to spend a week with us. I already thanked him, but I mean, it's an opportunity to do this in public. Here in Geneva, and to present the results of his recent research today. Mark will speak for about an hour and 5 minutes, after which we will have a questions and answer session. Just if you have clarification question, you can interrupt, but otherwise all sort of most substantive questions are better kept for the discussion afterwards. Mark, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Mark. I then also have the opportunity to thank you again for having me for the week, and thank you for attending. So my presentation will be based on joint work with a co-author of mine for a long time, Sasha Becker, as his name is at the University of Warwick, and more recent collaborators, Hartmut Egger, he is at the University of Bayreuth, and Michael Koch, who's there as well. And a more dated collaborator, Carolina Ekholm. She's now in Stockholm at the Treasury Department. The overall topic is to inquire how the progressing globalization of, in this case, an industrialized economy, Germany, and automation technology and its adoption impact on what workers do on their jobs. And once we know that, draw conclusions as to how the nature of work will change and the economy-wide aggregate will undergo changing inequality and changing employment patterns. There's a nexus now, it's been established in many different ways in theory and in empirical work, between globalization and wage inequality within industries and occupations. That's important to stress because more classic trade theory, this year is 200 years of Ricardo's seminal work on how trade and comparative advantage work. But much of trade can actually be explained by what is happening within industries and occupations across and within firms or plants. Wage dispersion is strongly explained by what is happening between plants, especially the change over time. And in the cross-section, most of the wage inequality we realize can document is in fact within employers and within these employers within jobs. So similarly, skilled workers, depending on what employers they work for, can command very different wages. The talk today will look closely into this interrelation between what job requirements are and how the wage outcomes look, and try to account for lots of different aspects of those labor market changes, including what could be called offshoring, the assignment of outsourced tasks to suppliers outside the country, export participation of local firms, and importantly also technical change. The focus will be on what I will call tasks. Think of them as the activities, the workplace requirements that might be or might not be in a formal job description, and that workers have to conduct when they carry out their work. And I will build that kind of evidence using employer-level data that are linked, at least in much of the evidence I'll show you, to the individual worker and the individual job. And I'll combine that kind of task information with those detailed data that identify not only the employer, the firm or the plant, but also the individual worker inside. There's a broad literature on much of these topics, and I think I would it would be wrong to not mention those in the given short amount of time. It's just a highlight of what's been done. So there's a large literature on how the wage distribution changed in many industrialized countries, also now in developing countries, and that's been termed polarization. Over the last decade or two, we've seen wage increases on both ends of the skill distribution, low-wage and high-wage earners gaining relatively more than the middle range of the skill distribution, the middle-skilled workers, who may, in some countries, have lost in real terms, and in many countries not have experienced the same gains as the other two groups. And that's been linked to offshoring. There's a theory literature on these things that link these changes to trade. So using classic and modern trade theory to look inside firms or industries and check how the task assignment is potentially explained by trade. Probably not too surprising to many of you, the better we match workers to jobs, the higher the efficiency of the firm, the lower its training costs. That's been documented. And also, the more automated the workplace becomes, the easier it is to assign more complex tasks to individual workers. There's a large literature on the human resource practices documenting that it often the widespread productivity differences between firms and also between typical firms across countries can be largely explained by how they adopt different management practices. And those, again, you can view as how management assigns tasks in the right way to its workers. And you can ask whether that is within or between hierarchies. I'll come to that in a little bit. Trade, and for that matter, many other economic changes may change how firms match to workers. And the more efficient these matches are, that is, the more directed the assortative matching is between good employers and good workers, the higher the efficiency gains that an economy can command. As globalization progresses, that matching may improve. I've myself done some work on that in the context of Brazil. The four authors, Davidson, Heyman, Natush, and Shurum, that I cite here, who work together with Chu, show that for the Swedish economy. What I'll talk more about today is that within firms or within plants, the matching has also arguably improved. That is, tasks are assigned more specifically to the workers that exhibit the highest ability at performing them. And that goes a long way in explaining what Lazier and Shaw thought of a major pattern in international wage determination, namely that it is not how well workers are matched to firms, predominantly, but really the dominance of the wage dispersion seems to be explained how well employers match their workers to the right jobs. And so the Lazier and Shaw have a summary chapter in a book of theirs in 2009 that makes this point very strongly. So just to set the stage a bit, why should we care? Why this new look at labor market outcomes? Skills have been shown to matter. Other background measures of workers' training and abilities. Why look at tasks? One of the reasons is that arguably offshoring, new forms of trade, and new forms of automation change the workplace mostly because of what tasks can be performed. A simple example is high-skilled workers, radiologists, who are trained with many years of medical school, can now perform their diagnosis remotely. In fact, chances are if you go to a hospital, maybe even in Switzerland, certainly in the United States, and have a radiology performed, that parts of the diagnosis will be conducted remotely by specialists in India or elsewhere who often have a US training but do the basics of that diagnosis remotely. Higher-end diagnostics are still done onshore or at the home location. So high-skilled jobs are now offshoreable. At the same time, jobs that typically require less training, such as, say, a janitor's job or a maintenance worker's job on site cannot be easily offshored because they require the physical presence. So this kind of perspective tells us that we may have to reconsider how globalization and automation impact the workplace, looking at the task dimension. So the perspective that I'll take will include technical change and automation as far as we can tell what's going on, and mostly focus on individual plants and how they assign tasks to their workers, and in particular, how many tasks they assign. So I will concretely discuss the evolution in Germany. Why Germany? Because we have outstandingly precise data. They span a period of about 35 years with surveys of workers that have been conducted in extremely similar, if not identical, ways in waves of about, in intervals of about 6 to 7 years. And they allow us to also observe concomitant changes, simultaneous changes in offshoring, exporting, and technology use. In the end, I will very briefly, in fact, it will be just 2 minutes, tell you how we can embed all of this in more substantive theory, and then ask what will be the consequences for economy-wide outcomes, such as wage inequality. Much of my talk, though, will be based just on presenting to you basic statistics that will be very suggestive of what those more elaborate models can deliver. So concretely, the data will be what, in English, I like to call the German Qualifications and Career Survey. If you later on see my slides, the source will always say BIBB. That's a four-letter abbreviation for a German employer agency that conducts this kind of survey every 6-7 years since 1979 in very similar ways. I'm not sure how much you've been exposed to this way of thinking in terms of tasks. What's out there has been mostly based on how jobs are performed. That is the second dashed line in this list here. Of those, we have 9 types, more than other studies, and I'll call them mostly performance requirements. So the questions will ask things like whether or not you have to conduct repeated work steps, whether it's routine, what you do, whether it's easily codified, what you'll be assigned to do, whether you often have to adjust to new situations or improve work steps. All this has to do with the how of what you do on the job. The beauty of the German survey is that these questions are asked repeatedly for workers, and they also report what occupations and industries they employed in. So we can observe those task changes within occupations and industries, and I'll emphasize how important that actually is. And the second advantage is that the German survey also asks what people actually do on their job. So if you think of the typical notion that multitasking has gone up, that's not well measured by the description how you do your job, because that's not cumulative. You wanted some notion of accumulating types of work steps. And I call those activities. And they're also surveyed, and they include things like, do you produce a good on your job, do you physically manufacture? Do you develop a research? Are you in construction of physical objects? Do you organize and plan your work and that of others? And do you oversee and control work steps of others and similar things? So they are naturally accumulating. And I'll document to you that in Germany, indeed, those tasks have accumulated over time within occupations. The survey is conducted only for workers that have at least a part-time job of 20 hours a week. And they survey about a tenth of the workforce. I've done much work with this before. Cite here 2 pieces of research that have been published. Much of my evidence today will actually be based on ongoing work that is yet to be published. It's available in the form of a working paper. So here is a quick overview of how changes in Germany happened. So if you conduct, if you ask how routine the work steps are on your job, then most workers, about 40%, said so in 79. And the share has basically been stable at 45% for most of the period and increased slightly to about half now in 2012. If you ask them how codifiable their work is, that is, how easily simple instructions need to be followed, a large share of workers says that that's satisfied, and that's slightly increasing too. There is evidence that that's not the case in the United States, and I'll briefly comment on why. One is maybe the United States are indeed different, so it is good to look at more countries. Another hypothesis is that their data don't really show what the German data do. Namely, in Germany, we observe these reports per worker over time in a random sample of the workforce. In the United States, the surveys are done at very large intervals. And the years that they report on, which don't quite entirely line up with the German years, but roughly, in those, actually, the workers haven't been resampled and resurveyed. So what the data do is they impute onto the occupations what the likely task content is. So when you now see a drop-off in the United States, that could also just be that the occupations that were initially very intense in these routine tasks are going away. But in the new occupations that take over and expand, we don't know whether they're actually more routine intensive or not. And that could very well happen. So that's something to sort out. I just put it out there as a caveat that the German evidence may be different because Germany is different, or the United States, for that matter, might be different than the rest, or just because the data work in Germany is more precise than it can be in the United States. So I'll go now through a few questions, and I'll try to answer them as we go. So one question one may immediately ask is, how do the tasks at German workplaces actually evolve over time? And the answer is differently depending on what you look at. So in the interest of time, I'd probably typically just move to specific elements of many of these tables. What I show here is how many tasks in the terms of performance requirements, namely, how you do your work, apply. That is, can your work be described as codifiable? Do you have many routine tasks to do? Do you often have to adjust to new situations? This kind of stuff. And as one might expect, that doesn't change much. Because how you do your job is not necessarily naturally accumulating. It's an aspect of how we describe your job, but not something that you need to add on as you work. And the distribution is relatively stable over years as well. Now, when it comes to activities, it's completely different. Activities are the questions as to what you're actually doing on the job, such as do you produce, do you design, do you organize the work of others, do you oversee others, and as you can tell, that tremendously changes in Germany. In 1979, workers reported on basically the same questions that they had to do about 1.5 to 2 such different tasks. By 2012, those are 7. So that's an increase of about 6, a factor of 6. So strongly, multitasking has increased in Germany. Yeah? So the question is how it came about, and the answer is, I highlight here in blue all the fractions that are more than 10%. So as you can tell, the mass of people is just moving down from doing very few tasks to doing more and more over time. And we end up at 7 now. The biggest jump was in the 1990s, in fact, something that may have to do with a trade opening towards the Eastern European future accession countries, or with automation, as I'll soon argue. Now, the answer to the question how tasks evolve in Germany, therefore, has two parts. The performance requirements don't change much, as one might expect by the nature of these questions. They are basically what they are. You do the job how you do it. But what you're doing on the job, the activities you perform, that has strongly increased by a factor of about 6 out of 15 max. So there are maximally 15 such activities we can record. And now the average is that people do about 7 of them. Now, how do these things vary between employers, especially the activities that I talked about? How do you discern employers? Well, one distinction is by size. So what I plot here is the plant employment, a simple size measure. And as you can see on the horizontal axis, I show the number of activities that workers conduct relative to what workers conduct in the smallest firms that have 1 to 4 employees. And you see this very strong and significant increase by employer size for most companies except the very top. So that means, decline, I should say. So that means the larger the firm, the narrower the task range that these employers assign to their workers. In other words, large employers, and that's the theory to which I'll build with more evidence, split the range of things that need to be done for a finished product to be produced into narrower and narrower categories, occupations, and because they split up that big work chunk into smaller partitions, workers can each perform a narrower range of tasks. That is not true for the very top. They actually increase again slightly, which arguably may have to do with automation. I'll come back to that. Whereas this pattern can easily be explained by employer size, and therefore will likely relate also to how well they do exporting or not. So globalization, I'll just briefly preview because I go fast again later. Globalization can very well be behind this pattern in the sense that we know that larger firms are more globalized. They tend to export more, and they also tend to offshore more. But larger firms, by this nature, by this fact, also split their work range into more occupations and then assign narrower task ranges to each of their workers. That would mean, if Germany globalizes more, we'd see less multitasking. Because the more globalized firms will reduce the range of tasks that they require from their workers. So something else must be driving the increase in multitasking that I just showed to you. And that is likely automation. Yeah? I've spent the week here, and the most frequent question I get asked is how are trade and automation related? And the answer is typically they're very hard to discern, but here might be a case where they actually have very different consequences. So the answer to how many assignments there are is, at large employers, there's a much narrower range of activities that workers need to perform. Except for the very biggest employers, the top plants seem to assign slightly more activities than the medium-sized firms. Now, how about automation? So what I show you here again is a simple tabulation of the number of tasks, activities that workers need to perform, 15 at most. Here I stop at 12 because there's not much beyond. And I show you the year 1979. What you see is that in the two other task dimensions, whether what you do is easily codified in instructions and what you do is very routine because it requires repeated work steps, those dimensions, they vary a bit. If you stare very carefully, maybe you detect some kind of shape in the distribution, a slight U if you wish. But largely, there's not much variation. The big variation comes in terms of computerization and automation. Computerization asks, on your workplace, do you use a computer or a workstation or a CAD, computer animated design equipment? Automation asks, on your workplace, is the main tool that you use a robot or another type of automated equipment? Yeah? Both of them strongly increase, or mostly at least, there's some outliers in between, with the number of tasks that a worker is assigned. Now, to be very careful, these are the tasks that are assigned to the same worker and the automation technology also given to the same worker. It's not about other workers being automated and you doing more tasks. It's about the worker, him or herself, conducting more tasks with the assistance of automation technology or IT. And that seems to strongly drive the adoption of multitasking. Now, that's 79. If you look at the blue numbers, they jump up tremendously. So it was less than 10% of the workers reporting in 79 that they had a computer. Probably not so surprisingly, that's up to 40-some percent in the subsequent period up to 2006. I don't use 2012 here. You might wonder why. The answer is there. The question's changed in ways that are subtle to resolve, and I just don't show them today. We'll figure them out, and I'll report later. In the backup slides, if you have them, I actually show you what it would look like if we didn't do any adjustment. And also automation went up by a bit to now roughly 10%. And you see again, the numbers are way larger, but you see this monotonic increase. That is, the more automation penetrates the workplace, the more multitasking the jobs become. Yeah? In other words, one strong candidate to explain the general increase in multitasking in the German economy is that automation technology came about and allowed it. Now, the answer to the question, how do these activities relate to IT then, is that, and to job requirements, that the common categories of codifiability and routineness may not be good indicators for how technology works. They sometimes are used in lieu of that. But really, the direct observation of what people have as tools on their workplace is what shows the big covariation, and both automation and computer technology strongly associate with multitasking. The big other question in the room is probably how offshoring relates to this. So how does the ability of German companies and industries to outsource some of the intermediate work steps to suppliers abroad relate to how the German workplace changes? And as I showed you in this brief literature review in the beginning, that's where much of the earlier discussion has focused. The argument that I made with the radiologist is precisely about this. Services are not tradable. The radiology image is transmittable easily to India. And that routine diagnostic job of a radiology interpretation can be conducted at a distance, a large distance. Yeah? So offshoring is arguably related closely to how routine or codifiable tasks are, and not necessarily to the skill level of who performs them. So what do we know about offshoring? Well, another beauty of Germany is that they have very carefully recorded so-called input-output matrices that show which industries ship to which other industries. And they do the recording differently for the domestically sourced and the foreign sourced inputs. So imported inputs are tabulated separate from the non-imported domestic ones. So we can actually tell exactly how offshoring evolved. So they use some additional data. Mark just gave me a little shorter time than I had expected. So I'll jump through the data source slides. Just believe me that we try to carefully account for things. And I'll just show you the results. So what I show you here on the left is how many imports by products are coming into Germany. That's mostly increasing. Agriculture actually was a slight decline, but now has also picked up again. The question is how many of those imports go directly to the final consumer, and how many of these imported goods get to industries who then process them and make something else. Those are the intermediate inputs that are imported. Yeah? So any import can have two uses at least. And I focus on those two. One, it goes to the final consumer directly, and the other one, it goes into another industry for further transformation. The second, I will call imported inputs. Yeah? Imported intermediate inputs, to be really precise. And what you'll see is that if you take that perspective on offshoring, we are about 30 years late in research emphasizing the importance of offshoring, because Germany offshored more in 79 than it did now in more recent years. The share of imports that go to further processing, the share of imports that are inputs for other industries, has declined. Or in other words, the overall number of imports that go to final consumers has risen more quickly than the offshore use. That's a fact, I think, to keep in mind, because it says that offshoring might be an exaggerated component of trade if you don't really have the exact statistics. For at least the German economy, offshoring is no news. For German researchers, including me, it is. But the German industry has been doing it for 30 years. You can also tabulate that by industry. Let me not do it. The point is made. Now, as so often, it depends on how you ask the question as to what answer you get. How important is offshoring to the German industry? You could also ask, how much of any given German industry's inputs are coming from abroad? So you don't decompose what the imports do, whether they go to the final consumer or an industry. You ask, for any given industry, when it outsources to suppliers, does it use foreign or domestic suppliers? And there, the story is indeed that offshoring has risen. So overall, if you divide the value of intermediate imports in a typical German industry's production value, that is, if you ask for the final good whatever price it fetches, how much of that price is attributable to the cost of the imported inputs? The answer is it was 7% in 79 and it's now 11%. That is an increase. Whether or not you find it substantive is a matter of judgment. What hasn't changed is the degree of outsourcing. Yeah? By outsourcing, we mean that you assign a production step to a supplier. That's around 50% back in 79 and now. The only thing that has changed is instead of outsourcing to a domestic supplier, more of the outsourcing is now going to a foreign supplier. And that's increased from 14% to 21%. Yeah, so that's driving the numbers. The German industry has always outsourced as much as now. It's just broadened the supplier base to include more foreigners. In that sense, offshoring has risen. Yeah? Whether you find it strong or not is another matter. So that's the summary. How has offshoring changed? Well, depending on how you ask, hasn't changed in terms of, it hasn't risen. In fact, it has fallen in terms of how much of an import is meant for further transformation. But it has gone up in the sense that offshore outsourcing is now bigger than it used to be. Now, how does that relate to the job market? I run a bunch of regressions. I don't want to tell you exactly the way the sausage is made. Just believe me that it's a reasonable way to do it. And I'll tell you what the sausage looks like. Yeah? So you can look how the importance of a bunch of tasks, and you obviously cannot quite see what it says on the x-axis yet, how strongly the importance of certain tasks has changed over time in Germany. I'll zoom in a second. What I first want to show you is that if you condition on what industry and occupation the jobs are performed in, the tasks are performed in, you see much less variation than once, if you do not condition on that, you see much less variation than once you condition on the industry. Another way of saying that intuitively is the dominant action in terms of changing workplaces is within industries and within occupations. And that's maybe not a surprise to you, but important for trade, because classic trade theory explains the trade pattern at the level of industries and occupations and not within them. Yeah? Novel trade theories that focus more on firms individually within these industries and occupations and how they operate, they have something better to say. Yeah? So the big variation is within industries and occupations. That's where the change is going on. And so now I'll just step over here for a second. I'll actually zoom in on the right panel so that you see what it actually says. So here, I show you for 3 years, 79, 86, and 2006, the relative frequency, that's how the estimation works, the relative frequency of how certain tasks are conducted compared to production in the job. Yeah? So all workers have to report whether they do any of these 15 activities, whether they produce, they repair, they purchase or sell, they practice law, they train others and educate, they nurse or cure, they organize or plan, and so forth. The dominant activity in 79 was, in relative terms, producing. By the year 2006, the dominant activity is consulting and informing. That's what I'm doing here. So I'm not very unusual. This standardization here is both in terms of all tasks and in terms of years. So the standard task is producing in 79. So the whole curve has turned up. Yeah? And it used to be that producing dominated, now it's being dominated. And more high-end activities, if you wish, such as coordinating others and consulting and informing, if you think of them as higher end, have started to dominate. In terms of performance requirements, this is how things changed over time. Again, most variation is within industries and occupations. And the way that worked out is I take as a benchmark case the easily prescribed work, so that's the codifiable tasks. They used to be somewhat less dominant in 79, but the clearest change is actually not there. It's in improving techniques. So workers now need to work harder to improve the processes and work steps on their job than they used to. Overall, as you can tell, there's not much change, but we knew that from before. Yeah? So the action is actually in the activities that you perform, not in the kind of prescriptions how you perform them. How you perform them here, there's whether you're prescribed exactly what to do, whether it's codifiable, whether there's a lot of repeat work, that's the routineness we cite. And then there are other things that are highly interesting, I think. So do you face a lot of deadlines on your job? Do you need to concentrate highly when you do your job? And do you often need to adjust to new situations? As you'll see, those things actually change with globalization later. So that's this pattern. So the answer to how tasks shift over time is most shifts happen within industry occupations towards higher end activities, if you excuse the simple term. And the interpretation why this can happen is that obviously then industries and occupations that are intensive in those rising tasks need to be expanding. Otherwise, the evidence would be different. Now, how about imports? What comes into Germany? It would be nice if we just could impute, or could actually know, what task content a German import has. Turns out this kind of questionnaire is only asked for Germany, at least as far as we know. So it's impossible to make it direct. But with a simple assumption, we can presume that, say, most German trade partners have a similar, perhaps shortly lagging task composition in what they ship to Germany. So one way to do that is to just assign the German task content from 7 years ago to all the German imports. You can do it concomitant, doesn't matter much. The answer will be roughly the same. It's a dirty, quick answer, but it'll tell you a bit about what things do. So on the left here, I show you the activities. On the right, I show the performance requirements. The interesting part is what comes into Germany has a U-shape of this sort, which exactly complements the U-shape of what's done in Germany. So remember, the performance requirements, they didn't change much over time, but they had this U-shape. Now it's an inverted U for what comes into Germany, which suggests exactly that specialization in terms of activities happens also at this dimension of the workplace. For the activities, it's still the case that most imports are intensive in production. Yeah? So in other words, the German economy specialized in types of tasks that the imports don't provide, and vice versa. Production is still the dominant tasks behind German imports. What has changed most is, interestingly, high-end tasks are also coming in more into Germany with these imports, including programming a computer, or another one was here, that you consult or inform. Yeah, so while the German economy becomes more intensive in consulting and informing and these kind of high-end tasks, as I labeled them simply, the German imports do as well. Another way of putting that is that these tasks seem to be complements. When you do them a lot in Germany, you also focus on imports that embed them to a high degree. So the question how tasks shift, we do now more computer programming and informing. And the performance requirements, they didn't change much, but they nicely feature exactly the opposite shape of what German jobs do. You can also ask what types of trade flows predict those changes in Germany. And there are at least three types of trade flows to discern. Imported inputs that come to Germany, ready to be transformed into something else. Imports that come into Germany and compete with German products in the final goods markets. And exports from Germany. And interestingly, if you take that perspective, offshoring, namely the importing of inputs, and exporting move the labor market in the same direction. One potential explanation is it doesn't matter whether you offshore and therefore get to save costs, become more efficient and more productive, and penetrate your product markets more deeply because you have this cost advantage, or whether you directly get to export more because you invented a better product or changed the quality. doesn't matter much for the outcome. Both work the same direction. So offshoring and exporting help the seller, whereas import competition hurts the seller in the domestic market. So again, I jumped the regression design. What I quickly want to show you is that, as I said, imports and imported inputs, those are the dark black ones, and exports move the same way. Those are the left and rightmost bars, whereas the competing product imports in the final goods markets at home, they move the other way. What exactly they do? This is not conditional on industries. As I argued before, it's probably a bad perspective. Once we condition on it, let me again, use the right slide here. For performance requirements, you see the tasks that are most favored by this kind of changing trade pattern are new situations you need to adjust to, and some minimum performance requirements. And in this one, actually, this is the better one. I want to show that. I'm sorry. The top ones are, again, consulting and informing gets a boost from this trade integration. And interestingly, also practicing law. So potentially, international integration means that you also need to take legal precautions or legal steps to make it all happen. So but again, it's high-end tasks. Production goes down. Yeah. So Germany, the German economy specializes in tasks that are less conventional, more high-end, if you wish. So these are the conclusions. There's across industries, offshoring and exporting works the same way. And within industries, it's the high-end type of tasks, programming a computer, consulting and informing, organizing and planning that get benefited. And in the requirements space, whether you have to face deadlines or new situations also increases. So if you wish, globalization pushes you to higher-end tasks and also tougher workplaces in the sense that you're facing more uncertain and quicker changing environments. So you can also ask, of course, how the German labor markets interacts with all of these things. One question is, obviously, I asked that so far, well, how does automation globalization play out? But all of this is conditioned on how operational the German labor market is. And one thing you can do is you can ask how tight the labor market is. On an earlier slide that I skipped, I explained how to do that. One measure of tightness is simply to divide the number of posted vacancies in a region by the number of unemployed people in that region. With the idea that if there's lots of vacancies posted compared to a small unemployment pool, you have a very tight labor market and it's tough to hire. Conversely, if there are few vacancies and a large unemployed pool, it's not a tight labor market and easy to hire. And the answer to the question how those things interrelate is quickly seen in this comparison. Here I have industries that are exposed to low tightness, that is an easy environment to hire, and those that are exposed to high tightness, the task reassignments are way more responsive in a less tight labor market. That is, if it's easy to hire, easy to reallocate work in your region, then the task reassignments are quicker. Yeah. That I think is also an important lesson for the broader question how globalization automation play out. It much depends on the labor market conditions. A flexible labor market allows for quicker adjustments. So that's the answer. Tighter labor markets have a harder time adjusting. Now in all of that you might ask, have we really now explained everything? Or what about the conventional explanations, often at the industry occupation level, that trade and automation change skill demands? That is, different levels of education benefit more or less, some get hurt, by those economic changes. So to what extent do the conventional explanations still matter? There are different ways to do that. The way I want to present it here is I want to gradually move now to a more employer-specific perspective. I will move to what's called a multinational enterprise. Now, you might say that that's a somewhat big step, and I fully agree. Offshoring, in the broad term I presented it so far, can happen both within a firm and across firms. So offshoring can mean that you find a global foreign supplier that'll make the specific intermediate goods you need. That would be offshoring. It would also be outsourcing. You outsource to a third party. Now, you can actually offshore without outsourcing. And the guys who do that are the so-called multinational enterprises. They open plants of their own abroad. They become their suppliers. They ship across borders. As you buy the supplies from the foreign country, they cross your border. But those shipments never cross the boundary of your firm because you own the supplier. Now, that's obviously a very specific segment of the offshoring story. It turns out it might actually be the biggest. Statistics are hard to come by for the United States. One simple estimate is that about 40 to 50% of all imports that cross a US border don't cross the boundary of a US firm. They come from the US firm's own affiliated foreign suppliers. Yeah? So these are big guys. They are great to study. Why? Because you can actually observe how they offshore. You know, in certain types of data, what's the employment at their foreign plants. Yeah? So I look at them now because they're easy to study. I'm not saying that they're the full story. They're at best the half. Yeah? But they're easy to study. And they're especially easy to ask how these task changes happen. Again, a quick data slide. If you want to go back, look that up. The only thing I want to say here is between 98 and 2001, Germany underwent a tremendous globalization wave. Offshore production at multinational affiliates increased by about 600,000 people, 0.6 million. So what I show you here is for the manufacturing sector and also for services. So don't forget, services are a big part of the story. In fact, in all the statistics I showed you so far, services were always in there. Yeah, this is not just goods trade. This is also services trade. Here I show it explicitly. The high bars are the multinational German enterprises with foreign affiliates that they own. And the low bars are the non-multinational enterprises, the national German companies with no foreign operations. And as you can see, multinationals have far higher wage bills paid to high-skilled workers. That's both because they pay higher wages, but also because they have more high-skilled people. And I lumped the two together in the wage bill. The wage bill is wage times employment. So the high-skilled get preferential treatment, if you wish, strong employment prospects at multinationals. If you ask how many, it's a different dimension of tasks, and I skipped how they come about. If you ask how many interactive tasks these people perform that require interacting with other people, that is slightly higher at multinationals, not tremendously. And the non-routine tasks, which I showed become more prominent in German workplaces, they are a bit more clearly higher at multinationals. But what you can see already, just from these simple pictures, that none of this seems to closely explain the big wage bill differences for the high skill. Yeah? So it's already suggestive that the skill story still matters. The tasks have a new way to look at the labor market and how it works, but it's probably not the whole story. You can also document that in a regression, but given the short time, I will just skip this story. What it would have told you is that beyond the task assignment, skills matter for the outcome of offshoring. Yeah? Right. Another way to put it more broadly is if you just know what tasks workers perform but ignore their ability, you don't explain most of the wage. Yeah? You need to also know their skills to know why they're paid as much as they are. And that naturally leads me now to ask how actually the interaction of who is getting hired into which type of job with what type of tasks works. In practice. So the quick summary is skilled wages strongly matter still for offshoring, not just the tasks that people are assigned. So let me quickly intersperse all of this discussion with a way bigger question, which probably is on many people's mind. At least I got a lot of questions over the past few days on this. So what about wage inequality? So
some of you may have the notion in mind that the German inequality indexes were actually coming down for the past years. That's true if you take after tax all earnings. But it's after tax and redistribution, and it's for all types of earnings. If you just ask about wage inequality in the German economy, then the answer is that actually went up. Now, I skipped again a slide, you may have realized. So now I'm in the business of linking the German survey information on what people do on their jobs to so-called linked employer-employee data, where I know all the workers and their characteristics and the employers for whom they work, individually identified and trackable over time. I obviously need to impute what tasks they do from the other data source, but we do that relatively comprehensively, so at least we do believe that we got that done. What I show you here now is in that linked employer-employee database, what it tells us about the German log wage inequality evolution. So we take the log of daily wages, because that's what most people do. It dampens a bit the very high pay, so it might actually understate the strong increase in wage inequality. And what I can do in these specific data, where we know the employer, we can ask how much of the wage inequality in Germany is explained because wages, on average, differ between employers, and how much is explained because wages differ within these employers. Yeah, so the simple fact is large firms pay a wage premium. If you track identically skilled and in other demographics, identically characterized workers across employers, the same type of worker gets a higher wage at a larger firm. And we also know larger firms are exporters, so we could also say the same skilled people with identical demographic characteristics get higher wages if they happen to work at an exporter. Why? Well, part of it may be that they're unobservedly more able. The employer knows, we don't see it in the data, and they get those jobs, so they might be sorting on unobserved abilities, or they just got lucky. Chances are that there is unobserved ability, unobserved in our data, that employers know how to test for, and then they match assortatively more skill-intensive employers will hire more able workers. And you can ask, that's what we do here, how the dispersion of wages between employers relates to the overall evolution. And it contributes about half of the story. But the other half is there's actually substantive wage dispersion within any given employer. Now, I want to complement that with an even more narrow view of where inequality in wages comes from. So what I show you here is what I call residual wages and a decomposition. What are residual wages? Well, my business today is to ask what the new perspective on workplace tasks and arguably unobserved worker ability brings in new insights. We have already theories that explain to us how observed skill by education level is remunerated as the economy evolves. So I want to take away from the log wage all the components that are observed, the gender, the age, the potential labor market experience of a worker, and the skills that are observed, the education. I take them out in a so-called Mincer regression. For all of you who know that economic stuff, doesn't really matter. I take them away. And what is left is the residual. That's the part of the log wage that conventional theory cannot explain, because conventional theory needs education and gender and other things. But potentially what this task stuff is able to explain. So I use that residual wage, and I ask where its variation comes from. How much of it is within plants and between? And the answer is the bulk is within plants. That is, it's not a lot, and I quoted Lazier Shaw before, lots of the wage determination in countries is not how well matched workers are to firms. The bulk is how well they're assigned inside the firms to the proper tasks they should perform. Yeah, so that's one consistent explanation with this evidence, that it's the within plant dispersion that dominates the inequality. It's also within occupation. So if you think of an occupation as a job, the bulk is within the jobs, meaning just reading the job description doesn't really tell you what the people will get paid on that job. It's the type of job that is advertised, but then very differently able workers seem to be hired into those jobs. You can also do the combination. You can say, let's define a job as the plant's occupation. Then obviously you take away, and it's harder to explain stuff, but still more than half is explained within that. Yeah? You can ask, is it the hierarchy, the layer of hierarchy in the company that explains how much you get paid? And again, most of the variation is within these hierarchical layers. Yeah? So sure, the boss gets more than the production worker, but that's only a small part of the variation. That's at most 35%. The other 65 are within the same hierarchy and the same employer across the workers employed there. Yeah? Which I think is a stunning fact. It refutes the idea. I mean, I condition out on education here, but it refutes the idea that we need to worry most about the pay scale. A lot of the labor market outcome seems to have to do with how well workers are matched by their otherwise unobserved ability to the tasks that they perform. And you can do this triple interaction, do the plant, the hierarchy, and within the hierarchy layer, the occupation, and not surprisingly, you're down to the same number, 54%. That's still more than half. Yeah? So more than half of the log wage variation is inside employers, the same occupations across differently abled workers. Now, how to put that together with the task stuff? Well, here come three, these are three facts that just came out of what I said. So log wage inequality increases over time. The within plant component is about half. And once you look at residual wages, it's all within plants and occupations. So how does all of that inequality relate to tasks? In order to get there, in the end, we'll need a little theory, but I'll take only one slide for that. I'll show you a bunch more facts. Here are three. I'll show you that larger plants, I could show you, I didn't include the slides. Quite intuitively, it's been shown in many data, larger plants offer a larger number of occupations. Yeah? So probably quite intuitively, if you have a two-employee plant, those two employees will do everything from sales to logistics on the same job. If you have hundreds of employees, you will split up all the tasks that need to be performed to get a product from raw materials to a client in narrower and narrower occupation categories. So bigger plants have more occupations. Shouldn't be too surprising. What was a surprise to us, in light of the fact that multitasking went up so much in Germany, is that the big guys, large plants, large employers, assign far narrower ranges of tasks to their workers. How to make the two things consistent, I say in my hypothesis, well, if there is a complete range of tasks that need to be done by the end of the day for a product to go from raw material to client, if you split that up into many, many occupations, you can assign to each worker that performs that occupation a narrower range of tasks. Right? Basically, you split up the space of all the stuff that needs to be done and partition it into smaller and smaller chunks the more occupations you have. That's exactly what this says and suggests immediately what kind of theory we'll propose. And then last, and that's the most surprising to us at least, both overall and residual wages are dispersed more at larger plants. So if you want to bring all three together, one consistent explanation, that's the hypothesis, is that once you partition the big space into many, many occupations and arrange for very small task ranges for every worker, you can then also go and match workers very carefully by their abilities to the tasks that they're doing. That will raise efficiency for the firm, so become more productive. It'll also increase the dispersion of wages in the firm, because now you really discern exactly whose ability is best matched to what, and then they get exactly their marginal product. So you increase, at least under conditions, the wage dispersion inside the plants. Wage inequality goes up. And as I said, arguably that's where most inequality sits. Yeah? So it's within the plants, in fact, within the occupations, because you assign workers to very specific tasks. Now, if that's all, so first of all, I can show this to you. I do want to show it quickly. So you can relate the number of activities, that's the range of tasks that workers perform, to the size of the employer. And as I show here, this is negatively related. That is, the larger the plants, way smaller, if you do the numbers, is the range of tasks that workers at these plants perform. Yeah? So that's the second fact from the prior slide. One big worry is, and that's why I want to show it to you, these firms take all these decisions at the same time. So how can you say that it's size that drives tasks through ranges? One way to do it is to say, well, shocks abroad are probably unrelated to firms' prior decisions. They happen no matter what the German employers do. So when all of a sudden German employers have a chance to ship more abroad, they have a better chance of penetrating the export markets, then they get bigger, and then they'll have an incentive to reshuffle their work arrangements. That's called an instrumentation strategy, and for all the economists among you, I did want to show this. So once we instrument, that's the right-hand side of the table, the fourth, fifth, and sixth columns. There we instrument with German firms' exposure to foreign export opportunities, and we find the same things. That's fact two. Bigger plants, bigger employers assign smaller ranges of tasks to their workers. Fact three, they are more unequal. So here I take the residual wage inequality at the plants, and the bigger plants have more unequal pay. Interestingly, once we instrument, it's not their size that matters, but because they actually choose to pick a bigger number of occupations so they can partition the task range more narrowly. And that's what drives their inequality, exactly along the hypothesis that I put forward. Yeah? So that's the kind of evidence I wanted to show you. You can put it all together and then go back as to how German inequality will change. And here is long and elaborate theory models, five-point insight. Plants optimally partition the range of all the tasks into many or fewer occupations. The larger the plants, the more occupations they adopt. So that if they have many occupations, they get to assign narrower task ranges within each occupation. That raises the match quality to the workers. More able workers are put to exactly the right tasks. At the same time, as the German economy globalizes, either because of offshoring or because new export opportunities, it'll raise productivity because firms that grow larger will rearrange their workforce, assign more occupations, narrower tasks, and raise their efficiency, which will, on average, raise prosperity in the economy. But it comes at a price. Inside these employers, inequality will go up. Now, it's a remaining question whether the exporters who will raise inequality and the non-exporters whose inequality will actually go down because they do the opposite things, whether on average, net, wage inequality will go up. And that's where in theory starts to matter. If you quantify our model with the estimates that I showed you, the answer is inequality in Germany goes up because the exporters dominate the story. There are not many exporters. So a simple number is about 5% of all firms export in most countries. In Germany, it's 10 plus. There are not many firms, but they employ about half the workforce. They're large. Yeah? So they're concentrating employment, and therefore, once you quantify and parameterize how the task ranges adjust, you get this result. So let me conclude with some things that I'm comfortable stating with vehemence and adamantly. So the data clearly show that what one could term high-end tasks are more frequently performed now in Germany than they used to be. Among those so-called high-end tasks, I'd think of organizing and consulting activities that have to be done under deadlines, changing business conditions, many new situations coming up, you saw the statistics, and arguably tougher performance standards. Offshoring has been happening in Germany since 79. It's no news to German employers. It's news to researchers, maybe. And that does predict the observed task frequencies in these simple exercises that I showed you. I carefully say predict here. I'm not saying causes. I hope carefully documented that task ranges are smaller within larger plants, and that happens because larger plants divide the work range into more occupations. The news, once you put all together and into a theory model, is that globalization can raise inequality everywhere in the world with this within firm channel, including in the foreign economies outside Germany. So those are things that I can state. Now let me speculate a little more and then end with a suggestion. I can't prove it. I don't have another theory model to do it. But multitasking is not explained by what I showed you. In fact, I failed to prove one of the main features of change. I'm convinced that we've gotten right the story of why within plant wage inequality is changing in Germany as a function of globalization. The story is exporters split their work range into more occupations, assign narrower tasks, raise efficiency, and raise inequality within their plants. But they shrink the task range. That is, multitasking goes down when firms become exporters. So, and when they offshore, if you want to extend the model. So globalization does not explain one of the main features of Germany's workforce change. In the early statistics, I documented that multitasking is highly associated with adoption of automation technology. So the bigger story in that regard in Germany, and that goes back to the question I get asked so much, is technology probably is a main driver of the workplace change in Germany. And technology and trade might be secondary under this perspective. Now, that doesn't say that we don't need to fear inequality from that process. In fact, most theories will tell you that technology adopters will also be the big firms. And again, they will pay a wage premium. So if you have some early firms adopting automation, others lagging behind, chances are the between firm or between plant inequality will go up. Yeah, so again, automation technology is also likely to raise inequality this time because of between plant effects. Now, you put this all together in thorough theory, I've not seen any convincing model that would then argue that prosperity goes down. Right to the contrary, every single model I can think of will generate with both automation technology and globalization that those firms that early adopt will raise the economy-wide prosperity, what's called welfare in those models, per capita incomes, if you wish. But at the cost of probably worsening the distribution. Now, here's my final suggestion. Of course, you could slow down technology adoption and globalization in order to make sure that inequality doesn't worsen. That's only part of the story, though. First, most of these models will also suggest that past a certain threshold of technology adoption or globalization adoption, inequality will start coming down again when it's between employers. So then you don't even need to slow down. You actually should speed up in order to get the double dividend of declining inequality. And even if you're afraid that they're in the wrong arm of this inequality change, there's a simple saying in English, and it is, don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. If you want to raise prosperity, embracing automation technology and globalization is, as the statistics show and the models that explain them suggest, the way to raise prosperity. At the expense of some more inequality, but there are other means than slowing down technology and innovation and slowing down globalization in order to achieve distributional objectives. Good, so the baby's still in the bathwater, and I finish, thank you.
Thank you, Mark. I know it's already relatively late, but I'll still open up the floor for a few questions. I'll take maybe four questions in total, so please raise your hand if you have a question. Yeah.
Well, thank you. I would like to thank Mark for his lecture. It has been a bit complex, and probably I will ask him to make it available to us, either through a soft copy or whatever means is possible, so that we relook at the lecture. But I can see these questions of task shifts, automation, and wage differentiation among workers would depend highly at the level of automation or the skill, and also at the level of skill specialization and differentiation among workers. Now, I come from a developing countries, in fact, at least developed countries. I do not see how this works for us. Because Germany, yes, it is highly developed countries. How would you apply this research to a developing country like Uganda?
Well, I guess I'll take four questions and then give you an opportunity to respond. Any other questions? Yeah?
I have several in reality. I go for some. One is at a certain point. So if the question is the following. So we were discussing with Mark before, and one issue that came up is that wage inequality really matter when there is a little social mobility. So if there is wage inequality, but you know that you can quickly eventually be the one who shifts into the higher paid job, then that's maybe less of a problem. So my question to you is, on one hand, we seem to be more concerned about wage inequality now than in the past. But if, in a way, or at least now it's central, but if wage inequality comes from within a firm, wouldn't you expect that it's easier, to get the high pot, the high wage, if it's the movement within a firm or not? Is this because it's more difficult? So is that sort of non-mobility within a firm, so that becomes, or one should say, okay, if it's mainly within a firm, then you can easily get to the job with the higher paid. So that was one question. The other question, so your story of multitasking and how it fits or not fits with the story. Would that work? That you say you said more and more, you're getting more and more multitasking. And you also said that small firms are multitasking. So could that be a selection issue, sort of when you open up more small firms enter into business of exporting, and given that they're more multitasking, you get more multitasking?
Are there any other questions? Okay.
So thank you for these questions. They're thoughtful comments. I have not worked on Uganda. I have worked a lot on Brazil. I cannot tell you how the within plant distribution changes in Brazil as they globalized. They underwent a big shock during the 1990s with trade reform. What I can tell you, if carefully worked on that, is how the between firm dispersion changes in Brazil with trade reform. And actually, it's a great example for how inequality and prosperity relate in their case. So as I mentioned, if you have some employers that pay a higher wage than others because they're larger and share the surplus they generate with their workforce, even to otherwise equivalent workers, then you will raise inequality as some firms pull away from others. Some become exporters, others stay behind non-exporting. If the whole Brazilian economy were non-exporters, no one ships abroad, or at the other extreme, the whole Brazilian economy were all exporters, inequality in Brazil would be the same. It would be driven solely by the ability distribution of how their workers' skills look. In between, as some firms start to export and others not, or if you go back from full globalization, some start non-exporting, you'll have more inequality because there will be this between-firm dispersion of the wage. Now you can ask, where did Brazil land? Obviously there is an inverse Kuznets curve, inverse inequality. As you globalize further, initially inequality goes up and then it drops again. At the two extremes, it's the same. We estimated it. Brazil happened to liberalize probably at the right time. It was short before the peak of its curve and basically cashed in on the double dividend. It raised prosperity and reduced log wage inequality. So that's as much as I can say for a developing country. It's very hard to figure out what tasks Brazilians perform because no one reports it. We could, as some have done, simply impute the German tasks and pretend the Brazilian workforce performs exactly the same tasks as Germans in their occupations, but that would probably be a little rough, so we haven't done that. So I cannot speak to the within-planned wage dispersion, how globalization affected it in Brazil, but on the between part, I'm confident we have a solid answer. And it is Brazil liberalized at the right time and cashed in on the double dividend. On the other questions regarding wage inequality and small non-exporters. So wage inequality and social immobility is a very good point. Obviously, one simple answer to addressing inequality without slowing down globalization or automation is to retrain the workforce and help achieve the social mobility from low-skilled occupations and the moves into higher skilled. And I think it's a wonderful thought to suggest that retraining of that sort might actually be incentivated within employers rather than, as most activating labor market policies now do, in outside training facilities that then reinsert the workers into another workplace. How to make this happen in practice, I don't know. What I can tell you is that the German data include information on within-firm training programs, but in the 350-plus questionnaire, those are questions that we haven't really worked with yet. But I am fully sympathetic to the thought that maybe our focus on social mobility being retraining outside employers could be rethought to include retraining within employers. Whether or not smaller firms would, whether or not globalization would induce smaller firms to become exporters and therefore more multitasking, I don't know. The model would suggest, that's the one best explanation for our data, that it would go the other way. As globalization, as trade costs fall and even smaller plants or firms can now successfully penetrate the export market, those non-exporters that shift into exporting will grow bigger, they'll partition their workspace into more occupations, adopt narrower task ranges, and then under the parameters we estimate actually raise inequality as well. So there the answer is unfortunately no. Good. Thanks again.
So just in case someone has a very burning question, I'll take it. Otherwise, we'll stop here.
Thank you again, Mark.
Thank you.
Many thanks.
Thank you for attending. You now probably have realized that we inform you about the next lectures on our website. I'll just leave it
public.
Sorry?
Mention that everything's going to be made public.
Yeah. So everything is put on the web. We are online. We have not only a recording of the whole presentation, but also the slides and everything you need in the summary.
That's the WTO website?
Yes. on the WTO public domain website under, actually on the first page.
You will see. If you Google my name, WTO, as I did this morning, and lecture, you'll find it.